Good morning to each and every one of you who are worshiping with us this morning, both here in the sanctuary and also through the internet online. Those who are in the sanctuary, I would ask that you please be seated. Not only do I welcome you to the service, I also welcome you to come at the end of the service to the community hall where there will be tea and coffee and juice and refreshment and hopefully conversation and a chance to visit with one another. I regret to announce the death of, Norman Babcock, who passed away at St. Martha's Hospital. His service was here at St. James on Wednesday, and I would ask that you keep Susan and her family in your thoughts and in your prayers this coming week. Due to yesterday's predicted thunderstorms, we unfortunately had to decide to postpone the family fun day that we had planned. But we're not postponing it for long. We hope to reschedule while the summer weather is still here, looking at on mid or late September as a new date. We think this may even be a blessing as more animals may be available for the petting zoo. To all involved with the planning, we say a big thank you, and we will have a great event in September. So we're sorry it didn't happen, but it will happen in late September. Are there any other announcements from the community you'd like to share at this time? Reverend Peter will be back next week, and so things will be back to normal for you once again, and I thank you for the opportunity to be leading worship with you this past couple of, during this past month. As we prepare ourselves to begin our worship, let us pause for a moment as we open our hearts to the Holy Spirit of God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, sisters and brothers, we have been raised with Christ to new life, freed from every fear and granted every grace. Therefore, with hymns of praise and prayerful hearts, let us worship the Lord our God. Let us come together in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, you offer riches that no earthly pleasure can match. You pour out mercy and cover us with love. You show us true justice and offer us peace. You provide us with every need and offer us eternal life with you. In the midst of the glitz and the glamour of this world, nothing and no one shines with your brilliance. Bathe us with the light of Christ, illumine us with your Holy Spirit, and enable us to live only for you and not the perceived riches of this world. For we ask this prayer and all our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I would invite you to open your voices united to hymn number 339. 339. Many, many years ago, there was a young man called Damien. Damien was born in Belgium, and he entered the priesthood and joined a religious order that was primarily focused on foreign missions. Damien and two others were approached by their superior at their ordination, and they were asked to go to Hawaii. Now, when you and I think of going to Hawaii, we go, yippee, sounds like a great spot for me. But Damien was asked to go to a leper colony in Hawaii. And as he reflected and prayed about that, Damien knew that by saying yes to this, he would be sacrificing his life for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of these people. He understood that leprosy was a very contagious disease. It was a disease that robbed people of so much and ultimately led to a rather painful death. And yet, he said yes to this. And so Damien left Belgium and he arrived at this leper colony in Hawaii. And one of the things he first started to do was to look and accept each person that he came in contact with as a precious child of God. He saw the inherent dignity of each person, regardless of the disfigurement, regardless of what they looked like, and so on. And so Damien set to work. He helped them build homes. He helped them to build schools. He helped them to build a church. And Damien labored among these people for a number of years, until one day Damien realized the awful truth. He realized that he had contacted the dreaded disease of leprosy, and he was well aware of what the outcome was, but he never stopped caring and loving. He never stopped working until the day came and one of his greatest painful disappointments was his inability to say Mass and to give communion to the people because his fingers had fallen off. And Damien stayed with those people and became more and more ill until at last he died. He sacrificed his life. He gave everything he had for these God's children. And when we look at that sacrifice that he made, we can thank God for people like Damien, who were willing to give it all for the sake of Christ, Christ's church, and Christ's people. Damien never took things for granted. He knew his time was short with these people, but he also knew what the outcome would be. And yet, it didn't stop him from making that sacrifice. Now, God doesn't ask you and I today to go to a leper colony and sacrifice our life. But what God does ask of us is to make these little sacrifices and not to take for granted everything that we have, but rather to be thankful, to celebrate the gift of our faith, to give of ourselves, and to give to others, and as a part of all of our sacrifices. Therefore, let us be thankful for all of those many gifts that God has given us, and may we rejoice in giving back to God the gifts that we have. I would invite you to open your voices united to Psalm 65, found on page 782, Psalm 65. Praise is due to you, O God in Zion. To you shall vows be performed. The burden of our sins is too great for us. Blessed are the people who you choose and bring to dwell in your courts. With awesome deeds, you answer our prayers for deliverance, O God, our Savior. By your strength, you make fast the mountains. You still the raging of the seas. Those who dwell at earth's furthest bounds are awed by your wonders. You visit the earth and water it. The waters of heaven brim over their banks. Drenching its furrows, settling its ridges. You crown the year with goodness. The pastures of the wilderness abound with grass. The fields are clothed with sheep. The Holy Gospel for this Sunday morning comes to us from the Gospel according to St. Luke, beginning to read at chapter 17, verse 11. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priests." and as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He knelt himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go your way. Your faith has made you well." May the Lord our God bless to the reading of this holy gospel, and to the name of Jesus Christ be given glory and praise today and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable unto you, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. My dear sisters and brothers in Christ, this gospel passage is well known to most of us who have been raised in the church. The story of the 10 lepers who were coming along and ran into Jesus along the way. And if you know anything about leprosy, as I said earlier, is an extremely contagious disease. It is basically a sentence of death. And because of that, people recoil when they think of a leper or people with leprosy. And in the early days, before there was any medication that could eradicate the disease, people very often were placed in quarantine, or in the early days sent to the side of the village where they were to stay by themselves. As a matter of fact, in medieval Europe, many lepers carried a bell, and they rang that bell to let the people around them know that they were a leper. And so their lives were reduced to a terrible and pitiful condition because they were not allowed to exercise their civil rights basically within the community and were cast to the side. Many of them, and most of them, were reduced to becoming beggars, where they would beg for food, and that food would be dropped off, and they would take it and eat it. But they were not welcome into their own homes with their own family or within the community. In other words, they were shunned, they were dirty, they were unclean, and they were to be kept separate from everyone. It's interesting, a little aside, that there was a leper colony here in the Atlantic provinces. There was a leper colony in, I believe, Tracadie, New Brunswick, many years ago, which is now closed, obviously, because of medical technology and medical advances. And so you can imagine those 10 lepers, when they saw Jesus, they saw something unique and special about this man. And they had nothing to lose and everything to gain. And they cried out to Jesus, "Master, have mercy upon us." And Jesus then said to them, because he took pity on them, he said, "Go and show yourself to the priests." Now, that was the way things were done in those days. We don't have anything like that today. We don't have people walking up the driveway of any United Church manse, knocking on the door and saying to the minister, "I'm clean." And then the minister saying, "Oh, good, now you can come back to church and take part in community life." Those things don't happen anymore, but in the early days they did. It was the priests who declared whether you were healed or you were not. And so, as they went and presented themselves to the priests, one of them thought, "I want to go back. I want to go back to this man Jesus and give him thanks and praise for this wonderful gift of new life that he has given to me. I want to go back and say thank you. Thank you, thank you. You've restored my life within this community and within the world that we're living in." And so he comes back and he kneels down before Jesus and he thanks him for that gift. And Jesus asked a very simple question. "Where are the other nine? Did they not think about coming back to praise God and to thank God for what God has given to them? Where are they?" It was only this foreigner, this Samaritan, who came back to thank Jesus. The problem with the nine people who did not come back, they quickly took for granted their healing and their health. They took for granted, now everything is all right, I can go, live, do what I want, be a part of the community, and so on. But the guy who thanked Jesus looked a little deeper into himself and understood that I can live a normal life because of this healing miracle. And the healing miracle was not only a physical healing, but it was also a spiritual healing as well. He did not take Christ or take his healing for granted. And that leads us to today. How many times do we take things in our lives for granted? How many times do we say to ourselves, "Mom will always be there. Mom will always have dinner on the table when we come home from work or school. There will always be a hospital in our midst. There will always be family around us," and so on. And we take all of that for granted. And we take the church for granted as well. There will always be a church down on the corner of Main and Church Street. There will always be a church in my own little community. Well, my dear friends, to take all of this for granted is a stupid thing to do. Because Mom, who makes the dinner every night, will not always be there. The school may not always be there. The freedom that we enjoy in this country may not always be there. And the church may not always be there. 10 years before I retired and moved to Antigonish, I worked as the conference personnel minister for the Montreal and Ottawa conference. And part of that job was dealing with all forms of issues and problems that were springing up in many communities. And one of the things that I had to do was to help congregations close and sell their village church. And this was a very painful and hard thing for the community to do. And I remember once going out to the eastern townships in the south of Montreal to a small community where a little group of people that were left could not maintain and sustain the church anymore. So they made that painful decision to close and to sell the building, along with its beautiful stained glass windows and lovely woodwork. They couldn't keep it up anymore. And so the night that the meeting was held, I arrived at the church, and the church was packed. It was filled. People standing at the back. And I looked out and I thought, well, why are you closing this building with all of this crowd here? And I remember this woman standing up and berating me and the United Church for daring to come to their community to close the church. And I asked her very nicely, I said, have you worked in the church and have you helped sustain it? And the answer was, no, but my great-grandfather built the church. Well, lady, your great-grandfather is long dead. And secondly, how dare you berate this small community and the United Church for doing what we do not want to do because of your inability to assist and your ability to take the church for granted. You did not help. You did not support it. You did not care for it. Now, you're weeping crocodile tears because there's no more baptisms, there'll be no more confirmations, there'll be no more weddings, and God forbid there will be no more funerals. You took the church for granted, and it has come back to bite you. Each one of us takes so much for granted. We take people that we love for granted. We take our freedoms for granted. We take our faith for granted. And I'm as guilty as anyone else. I have a tendency at times to, when things are going fine, to just say a quick little prayer. Thank you, God, it's been a great day. Now I want to go to sleep. But when things and the chips are down, my prayer life becomes much larger. As I lay there in bed saying, oh God, help me understand this. Oh God, help me do this. Oh God, will you do that? Because I take God for granted so many times in my life. And yet, I need to stop that and to thank God on bended knee for every gift, everything that God has in the past and does today and will do tomorrow for my life. And the most important thing that we need to not take for granted is the sacrifice of Christ upon the cross, so that each and every one of us in this church today will have the gift of forgiveness, reconciliation, and life eternal. Where are the other nine? Well, we're here. We're here. And we need to go back and kneel at the feet of Jesus and say thank you for the gift of new life. Amen. I would invite you to open your hymn books to 266. 266. Let us come together in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God of love and justice, you have made it clear to us that the worship you want from us is an ethical life lived out in a society that we make just. Hear our prayers for your whole creation. We pray for your church universal and for all who live by faith, doing charity and advocating for social change. Cultivate peace between the nations, between churches, and between peoples of all the world. Protect and comfort those enduring the violence of war or crime or destructive forces of nature. And we pray especially today for the people of the Ukraine, the people of the Middle East, the people of Latin America, and we pray for the people of Pakistan as they cope with the flooding and the destruction. God, preserve those who suffer violence at home and bullying at school. Give courage to those who see their trouble to help bring relief to others. Grant your healing mercy to those who are ill or facing death, and uphold those who care for them. Gracious God, through Jesus Christ, you come to us and teach us the way of true worship, doing good, seeking justice, rescuing the oppressed, defending the orphan, and pleading for the widow. Renew in us your vision of justice and hope, that we may take part in your reforming work in the world. For we ask this and all our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I would invite you to open your hymn book to 424. 424. Let us go out into the world in peace, to be brave and keep hold to what is good, to never pay back wrong for wrong, to encourage the faint-hearted, to support the weak and the distressed, to give due honor to everyone, to be joyful and pray continually, and go with the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with each and every one of you and all who you love this day and forevermore. Amen.